In 2009, something happened that has truly changed my life. A group of men in the church that I was serving had a vision for investing in their pastor and sending him and his wife on a trip to the land of Israel, and to send us alongside another seasoned leader that we could be both inspired and sharpened. I have personally benefited from that experience in ways that I could not have imagined. It has literally shaped my life and ministry. Now, I would like to pay that forward. That is why I have developed the Catalyst Scholarship. Each year, Julie and I lead a trip to Israel that is designed both to educate and inspire. This year, I would like to take another pastor and his wife along for the journey. This is an all-expense-paid trip from Jacksonville, Florida to Tel Aviv, Israel. All meals, hotel, and travel are fully covered. Now, there are two ways that you can partner with us to make this possible. First, nominate someone. If you know of a pastor who is deserving of this scholarship, visit zachterry.org and click the tour button on the left-hand side and then fill out the nomination form. Also, give to make this possible. Your gift of any amount will be used to provide a pastor a once-in-a-lifetime, fully paid-for trip to Israel. Would you pray and ask God how much He would have you to contribute to sponsor one of His choice servants literally walking where Jesus walked? Some of you are able to give $25. Others are able to fully sponsor a pastor or his wife. Visit zachterry.org today and click tour to nominate or to give. I promise you, you will not regret it. We are in Exodus, the second chapter. If you have your copy of God's Word, go ahead and open it up there. Find your app. Find the second book of the Old Testament, second chapter of the second book. While you're finding your place there, let me glance around and see if I see them. They may have been in the first service, or they may be hiding. I'm not sure. Esther and Don Marquette, are they in here in this service? Wave your hand if you're in here. We're going to celebrate you whether you're here or not. They are celebrating their 60th wedding anniversary this week. Now, I looked up, I was just curious which anniversary this is. The 50th is the gold. Does anybody know what the 60th is? The diamond, that's right. That's right. The 55th is emerald, the 60th is diamond. And if Miss Esther sticks with Don for five more years, 65 is blue sapphire. So that's a legacy, man. That's just something that we need. What gets celebrated gets repeated. And we want that for all of our families in here. We want you to have a long, not only a long marriage, but a happy marriage. And they are the picture of just joy and fulfillment in Jesus Christ. So I hope that for all of us, that God will bless us in a similar way. Well, if you were here, we studied over the last few weeks this amazing story of what God is doing in redemptive history through the person of Moses leading the children of Israel out of Egypt into the Promised Land. The story really began at the death of Joseph. If you go back and study the end of Exodus, you see how Joseph's had these dreams and visions of how he would save the people. And his brothers despised him. They sold him into slavery. He ended up in Egypt, but there he rose in the ranks and became prime minister over Egypt and saved his people by seeing what was coming, an impending famine. And with that famine, he stored up to be prepared, not only for Egypt, but for all the surrounding nations. And in a sense, saved the world during that time. His brethren in Israel, or his brethren who were the children of Jacob, the patriarchs, came into Egypt seeking relief. And there they found that Joseph, as a type of Christ, had gone before them and made a way. Joseph was on the Mount Rushmore of the people of Israel at that point. As he died in his final days in Genesis 50, verse 24, he utters a prophecy. He says, I'm about to die, but God will visit you. And he will bring you up out of this land to the land that he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. For true believers, generation after generation, they remembered that promise, that prophecy, that one day God was coming. God would visit his people. Now they're growing literally up to as many as a million people. The Jews were a million people strong in Egypt. But the further you get away from a God moment, the more it begins to not resonate as loudly. You begin to question and wonder, well, did it mean anything? Was it literal? Was it spiritual? Was it metaphorical? In what way will God visit us? And in what way will he deliver us? Jewish families had sons and daughters. They continued to grow to this vast population. And then it happened, a regime change and all of the difficulty associated with it. A new Pharaoh arose who knew not Joseph. He owed nothing to the Hebrews. To him, they were less of a friend and more of a threat. You remember the story. They were enslaved, brutally mistreated. Ultimately, efforts to control their population were enacted with the prescribed killing of all the male children born to the Hebrews. But the prophecy of Joseph still echoed in the minds of the true believers. Among them were Amram and Jochebed. On top of that, Amram, we're told in tradition that he was visited by God in a dream. God told Abraham that not only would he deliver Israel, but he would do so through Amram's son, the yet unborn son that you know as Moses. And he would take the people back to the promised land. Therefore, Amram and Jochebed did not fear Pharaoh's edict when the baby that would be called Moses was 3 months old. They fashioned a basket out of bulrushes. They dabbed it with bitumen and with pitch. You got to get those words right. You say that too quick and you mess up. Pitch and bitumen. Pitch and bitumen. All right. Sending this newborn son floating down the Nile into the providential hand of Almighty God. Miriam, his 15-year-old sister, is running along the bank to see what God would do. Fear mixed with anticipation is filling her young heart. The basket comes to rest among the reeds in a place where Pharaoh's own daughter had come with her entourage to bathe. At first, it seemed like the worst possible scenario. The child had floated directly into the mouth of the lion. But this princess of Egypt was different. Bithia, the Hebrews would call her, was moved with compassion and she took the child in. Jochebed, the mother, was selected among the Hebrews to serve as a wet nurse for this baby. She was able to influence him, to teach him the oral tradition of the Hebrews, and to raise him as a Hebrew until around the age of 7, at which time he was moved to the Egyptian palace and raised among the princes of Egypt. He was educated as an Egyptian. He had an Egyptian diet, Egyptian health care, all of the best of that time. Then at the age of 40, he visits his Hebrew brethren, where he sees one of the Hebrews being beaten by an Egyptian taskmaster. He intervenes, he kills the Egyptian, and he hides his body in the sands of Egypt. He thought he got away with it. But someone saw and told the story until it ultimately came to the knowledge of Pharaoh himself. Moses, in fear, flees into the desert, going to the northeast, to the land of Midian, where the Cushites had settled and established themselves as herdsmen. Now, at 80 years of age, living in a foreign land, the story continues. The memory of his Hebrew brethren is no doubt still on his mind, but the pull that it had on his soul had grown weak. Remember the vision that his father had experienced. But what difference did that make for Moses? Because who knew if Amram was even still alive or Jochebed his mother? Perhaps Miriam and Aaron still lived, but who knows? That was a different life, a different world. Meanwhile, back in Egypt, another regime change occurred. Look at verse 23 of Exodus chapter 2. During those many days, now keep in mind, from the birth of baby Moses, 80 years has transpired. During those many days, the king of Egypt died, and the people of Israel groaned because of their slavery and cried out for help. Their cry for rescue from slavery came up to God. God heard their groaning. God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God saw his people Israel, and God knew. Now, that's a very significant verse, perhaps one of the most significant in all of Scripture. God heard, God remembered, God saw, and God knew. It's presenting God as not this distant deity that yearns for your worship, but this up close and personal God who sees everything that you go through, hears every word you speak. While the dreams and visions of the past are growing dim in Midian in the mind of Moses, they are white hot in the mind of the Hebrew slaves. That's how it happens. Sometimes when things are comfortable, when we have it easy, we drift from the things of God. But when the heat is turned up, when trials come, we cling to that which is eternal. They're clinging to the promises of the Lord, all of the hope and the promises that are held in these prophetic words of Joseph and this vision of Amram and hoping for a redeemer and wondering who it'll be and when it will happen. They're crying out to God day after day. And the scripture paints God as this passionate, white-hot vision of wanting to deliver his people. He's waiting for the fullness of time. Who knows what it was? It could have been a particular prayer that had to be uttered before God said, now's the time. Perhaps it was one of the taskmaster's whips falling upon the innocent back of a Hebrew before God said, that's enough. But at some point, God decided to fulfill all that had been promised. Back in Midian, Moses was not conspiring a theme of deliverance on top of a mountaintop compound, but rather he was keeping the flock, minding his own business in an occupation that was scorned by the Egyptians, that of a shepherd. Like the apostles after the death of Christ, before they were aware of the resurrection, they had gone back to their occupations as fishermen. The Hebrews, what they did best was herd sheep. And so it was very natural. It was in the DNA of Moses to go back to being a shepherd. In chapter 3, verse 1, we pick up. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. And he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness, and he came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Why did he go there? This was kind of out of the way, if you study the maps, for where you would typically think of a shepherd leading the flock. It could have been that that's where the grass was green and he was just following the herd. It could have been that there was something about that mountain that he just never could shake. It just kept drawing him back, a fascination that he had with that place. In verse 2, and the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. A bush that burns, but is not consumed. The subtlety of the language is very slight. It's easy to overlook. There are times when the prophets had these great and powerful visions. Elijah sees a chariot of fire coming down from heaven. Jacob sees this ladder that was a type of ziggurat, an ancient temple, a tower that reached all the way into heaven. Ezekiel sees wheels turning within wheels like a gear system. John the Revelator sees a lamb on a throne standing as though slain. But what Moses sees is more subtle than any of those. In fact, it was not the fact that this bush was burning that was significant at all. That sort of thing happens in the deserts of Midian. But it was not accompanied with all of those familiar things that you don't really think about until they're not there. When you see a bush burning, we have a fire pit in our backyard. If there's a fire in the fire pit, there's just a few things that it occurred to me this week as I was sitting out studying that if they were not there, it would be peculiar. There's a certain sound to the fire burning, right? You hear the crackling of the wood. There's a certain smell. I love the smell of a fire. And certain woods give off certain smells. It's just familiar. And there's certain smells that accompany. You hear things, you see things, there's smoke. But if nothing is being burnt, there's no smoke. And so this was very familiar in a sense. There's a bush burning, but there's no smoke, there's no smell, there's no crackling of the wood as it gives way to the fire. Something's peculiar about it. So Moses turns aside, he just gets his attention, it's a little out of the ordinary. It gets his attention. He turns aside to see what it's about. Verse 4, when the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. It was a familiar greeting, a double utterance of the name. It was like we would smile and offer an outstretched hand. It was a way of saying, I'm approachable. You don't have to be afraid of me. But then in verse 5, he says, don't get too close. I'm your friend, but I'm also your creator. He says, do not come near. Take the sandals off of your feet, for the place on which you stand is holy ground. It's like that prayer Jesus taught us to pray, where he said, pray then this way. Our Father, Abba, Dad, close and intimate and approachable, someone who loves you as his very own son or daughter. But quickly after you call him Abba Father, remember that he's your Father who is in heaven. He's the great and glorious creator who stepped out of nowhere onto nothing and made all things that are, has the very power of life and death at his disposal. So there's imminence that he's close, and then there's a transcendence that he's far above. The transcendence and immanence of God is echoed all throughout Scripture as this dichotomy that we hold in tension, both things being true simultaneously. So he says, Moses, Moses, I'm your friend. Come near to me, but don't get too near. Remember who I am. And this angel of the Lord that speaks out of the bush, this is not Gabriel, this is not Michael, for he goes on to say, God called to Moses. This is the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ, the second person of the Godhead, the eternally begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. He speaks out of the fire, that which both judges and purifies simultaneously. And he calls to Moses. Moses turns aside, he draws near. He says, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. The scriptures are known for understatement. I don't think you can grasp, or I can grasp, the fear that gripped the heart of Moses. So imagine the sound if you were to see God, if the creator of the universe met you in a private location, a secluded place, and he showed up, and he said, what would he say? I'm the God your grandma prayed to. Imagine how that would feel. He says, I'm the God of your father, Amram, and I'm the God of Abraham. I'm the one who called him out of Ur of the Chaldees. I'm the God of Jacob. His ladder ascended to me. I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and I'm the God of your forefather, Jacob. I am the God of your people. And so here he is, seeing God, this God that he had believed in, this God he had heard of from his mom and from his dad and from the Israelites by oral tradition. They didn't have a word of scripture written at this point. Moses would later write it, the first five books of the Bible. But at this point, he had just stories. Yahweh shows up and says, I am that God that you've heard of all your life. Now, there are some ways in which this burning bush that is very familiar, if anybody, even if you didn't grow up in church, you've heard this story. Charlton Heston, you know, the Ten Commandments movie, every Easter, they play it, and you see these depictions, the Prince of Egypt. You saw the Disney movie. I mean, there's these depictions of this story that have been told for thousands of years. And theologians can go really deep down the hole right here, trying to figure out, why was it a bush? Why was it a fire? What are those symbolic of? In what ways does those correlate to our experience? And in what ways are they not at all like our experience? And there's as much that can be said that you would leave out of here just as confused as they are. So what I want to do is the remainder of time is to try to draw some connections out of this experience before we go further into what God said. God's about to give the most amazing introduction of who he is to Moses. But before he does that and equips Moses to go deliver the people, let's camp out on these burning bushes. What are they? In what way do they cross over to your experience and mine? Notice it happened in a secluded moment. Nobody else was around but Moses and the sheep. It's something about solitude, getting out by yourself, going out on the beach, getting out on a boat, but going up on a mountain. There's something about getting alone that is a lost art in our day and time. It happened with a familiar object. One commentary said, why was it a burning bush? That's basically all that God had to work with. There were bushes and rocks there. It had to be one of the two. He used a rock for a different illustration later in the book. So the bush here was kind of the only possibility. For you, it may be something totally different. What is the equivalent of a bush in your life? What is normative in your life? It'll be familiar. It'll also be subtly different. No smoke, no sound, no smell. It was familiar. He had seen a burning bush before, but this one wasn't being consumed. Something's different about it. Fourthly, there is something about it that draws you near, and then there's something about it that's a little bit frightening at the same time. It's a transcendent imminence. And fifthly, it's a confirmable truth. He didn't show up to Moses and say, I'm something you've never heard of before. He shows up to say, I am the God who's presented himself to your forefather Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You've heard about me all your life. I'm that God. So it's a confirmable truth. It's rooted in revelation that one day Moses would write down. So, do they happen to us? Do they happen to you? Do they happen to me? I believe in some ways they do. Now, there are going to be things that happen to Moses. In redemptive history, you don't have another Exodus to the degree that Moses had an Exodus, where seas are parting, bushes are burning, and manna's falling out of heaven. You don't see it to that degree any other time in redemptive history. But there are some things that cross over. And I want to help identify those by just sharing a few testimonies with you this morning. Some of you could share some as well. The first for me was in 1994. I was a student at the University of North Alabama. Going to college, my father dropped out of high school, certainly didn't go to college, mom didn't go to college. We really didn't know what we were getting into. I didn't know what to expect at all. But I was there, and I'm at the University of North Alabama, first day of class. I got there early because I didn't want to be late, be that guy, you know, late on the first day of school. And so I get there early. I'm in my car, 1994 white Camaro T-top. Not important, but I'm just, you know, it's car week here, you know. So I'll let you know what I was driving at each one of these. But so there I was. I'm sitting out in my car. It was in Kilby School parking lots where the students could park across the street from Norton Auditorium. I'm there waiting on class to start, probably 8 o'clock. This happened probably around 7:30. And I'm sitting there flipping through the radio trying to find a good type of music to listen to just to get me kind of awake. And for you young people, back in the day, you couldn't just pick the song you wanted off your phone. That didn't happen. I mean, you sat there at the mercy of a DJ and you just prayed, you know, dear God, let him pick my song today. And if he picked your song, if your favorite song came on the radio, it was your day, man. Everything is like a downhill bicycle ride. This is going to be a good day because he played your song. And so I'm sitting there and I'm flipping through the radio trying to find that song. And I couldn't find any I liked. And so I stopped. I'm in a new city. I didn't know what station this was. I'm in a new city. I stopped. And it was a guy just that was talking. I thought it was the news. He didn't have a strong local regional accent. He spoke conversationally. His grammar was very well-spoken. I mean, he spoke well. I thought it was something like NPR. It was the news or something. And so for whatever reason, I thought, okay, I'm going to see what's going on in the world. This was right in the middle of the Iraq war kind of season. And so I'm curious. Some of my friends were going to be involved. And so I'm curious to get caught up on that. I noticed pretty quickly that this news anchor was talking about the Bible. He said, God made him who knew no sin become sin on our account that through him we might know the righteousness of God. It was a man named Charles Stanley at a First Baptist church in Atlanta, Georgia. I didn't know it was a preacher because the church that I grew up in, they were really loud. They were mountain preachers. We lived in the Appalachian foothills of northern Alabama, southern Tennessee. And so they were mountain preachers and they preached really loud. And the Bible says, if you love the Lord, you'll tithe, you'll come to church. So that's how preaching sounded. This dude just talking, you know, I mean, I don't know what it is. I thought it was the news. If I knew it was a preacher, I would have done turn the channel. He didn't have anything to say to me, you know, and I'm good. I'm right with the Lord as far as I know. Now, every time the doors were open, I was at church because that's what the edict of my father said. And dad told me growing up, he said, son, if you get too big for me to whip, I'll hire somebody. So I was at church. But growing up, I would go to church, you know, and half hung over some of the time. And I was doing what I wanted to do, you know, and just kind of a wild teenager, but I was at church. And so I'm sitting out there. The last thing I wanted to find was a preacher on the radio. And so here he was talking. I was embarrassed. I turned it down because I didn't want somebody to walk by and hear me listening to a preacher. I mean, I have to explain it. But I didn't turn it. There was something that drew me in. I turned aside, as it were, to see what was being said. And I don't remember every word of the sermon, but I do remember that he explained that for you to be forgiven and to know God, it's not so much about what happened back when you were a child at the altar or in the baptistry, but it's about what Jesus Christ did on the cross 2,000 years ago. He put all the emphasis on Jesus. Now, if you walked up to me at that point and said, are you a Christian? I would have said, sure. Everybody I knew was a Christian. I assumed I was a Christian. Yet when I looked at my personal experience, Jesus Christ didn't have a whole lot to do with anything. I believed he was real, like I believed George Washington was the first president of the United States. I knew he was an important figure, and he was a good guy. But to look at him as my hope, as my reason for living, not at all. And when I looked at my salvation experience, he would probably had something to do with it, but it was really more about what I did. I prayed a prayer. I got baptized. I walked the aisle. It's all about me. Charles Stanley said, it's not about you. It's about what Jesus did on the cross, his death and resurrection. That's the gospel. So I heard it. I listened to it. I went to class. Then I walked down to the drop ad office, dropped every class I had before 12 o'clock so I could sit out and listen to those radio preachers. I don't know how to explain to you why I did that, except it was just it was drawing me in. And then I would go and I would listen, J. Vernon McGee, Adrian Rogers, Charles Stanley, Focus on the Family, John MacArthur. I would hear all of these radio preachers, and they were discipling me, and they were speaking in unison, like a beautiful harmony of truth. And they were all pointing to the person and work of Jesus Christ as being what makes one a Christian, what makes one forgiven and gives them hope and joy and the abundant life. So it came to a climax in a number of weeks. I would say 2 or 3 weeks. I was in my apartment, sitting on my bed. I got out my little brown Bible, genuine leather, had my name in the front of it. I looked and I found that same verse. God made him who knew no sin to become sin on our account, that through him we might know the righteousness of God. I read more. The more I read, the more this was saying, what those men were saying. And it hit me. Man, salvation, being a Christian, it really ain't got anything to do with me. All I contributed was the sin. The rest God did. God did it all. Salvation's of the Lord, Jonah said. And so I heard one broadcast. It was an interview with a great apologist, Josh McDowell. And he explained how all of those first followers who saw Jesus witness the resurrection, the disciples who wrote the New Testament, those guys went to the ends of the earth proclaiming that Jesus was alive, and each one, except for John, who died a natural death, the rest of them died a martyr's death. And he made a statement. He said, you know, a man may die for what he thinks is the truth, although it's a lie, but very few men will give their life for something they know to be inaccurate and a lie. And these men don't give any evidence of being insane. And so for one after the other, to take the gospel as far as India, up into Europe, modern day Europe, Spain, proclaiming that Jesus is alive, and then tribesmen, priests, one after the other, put them to death, crucified upside down, boiled alive in oil, I mean, fed to the lions. They believe this. So I remember sitting there, my sinner's prayer was something like this: God, I don't know why, I can't explain it, but I believe it too. And I said, I want to believe it as much as they did. And I said, I don't know if that makes me a Baptist or a Catholic or a Methodist or a Presbyterian. There's a lot I don't know, but I do know I want to believe what those men believed. And looking back on it, that was my born-again experience. It changed everything. My life radically changed from that moment forward. Everything changed, the whole direction of my life. For me, 106.3 was a burning bush. The next came around a year later, 1995. Was driving a red, cherry red Trans Am, black leather interior. If you get a great car, don't sell it. You always regret it. But I was driving that car, and I remember going down in Florence, and I heard a guy, John Maxwell. I was listening to an audio tape, actually, of John Maxwell. But it was him preaching. He used to be a pastor. He's a leadership guru now, but he was a pastor at the time. And I remember he said something, and it just came to me. I didn't know if it was God or me or what, but it just kind of thought came to my mind. You could do that. You could do that. So I began to mimic. When he would say something, I would repeat after him what he said. and try to get the voice right and all that. And it was like, no, that's not what I mean. I mean, you could do what he's doing. And so after that, it seemed like every other sermon, it wasn't every time, but almost every other sermon I would hear, it seemed like I would sense this, you're supposed to be a preacher. You're supposed to be a preacher. I'm calling you to preach. But that's a scary thing. I'd worked my whole adult life at that point, as short as it was, toward moving to Nashville and working in the entertainment industry. My father had invested a lot of money in that. We had some family who was up there who could help me get into some great opportunities. And so I wanted to be a producer or manager or something like that. So I was working, that's what I was studying, and I was hearing God say, preach the word, over and over and over again. One Wednesday night, at church on Wednesday night, it was like a service like we have. They had preaching, they had offering, you know, everything. And this particular Wednesday night, a lady comes forward in a wheelchair. She rolls down to the front. Harold King, the associate pastor, was teaching that night. He received her, talked with her, and then he spun her wheelchair around and handed her the microphone. Now, I'd never seen her before. She was just visiting our church. Very unusual for this particular church to do that. But they handed her the mic, and Pastor King said, she wants to share a few words with you. And she went longer than what I'm going to say, but basically she said, folks, when I was a college student, I remember God was calling me to be a missionary. And she said, as I was wrestling with the call to be a missionary, I ran from God. And she pointed to her wheelchair and she said, I can't run any longer. She said, if God's calling you, you need to answer the call. And I sat there and I said, okay, I don't want to run from God. He's got a pretty good fight record. He wins all of his battles. That Sunday morning, I was in the choir of our church, big choir, and I'm standing up there and wearing a robe, and the invitation's given, and God says, now's the time. Unzipped that robe, picked up my Bible, walked up to the pastor, said, God's calling me to preach. I said, I don't know what to do, but he's calling me to preach. And Pastor Jeff said, okay, son, we're going to pray for you. Proud of you. I'm not surprised. We've all been expecting this. It kind of shocked me. It was a good day, but I was really scared to tell my father. I go home, I pick up the phone, and I call Dad because I'm thinking, Dad, you just have to know our history. Dad, we had an uncle who was best friends with Johnny Cash, who toured with Merle Haggard. I mean, we had connections in Nashville, so there was a very good possibility I could get some work up there, at least get an opportunity. And Dad had bought trailers and equipment, and we were doing shows around North Alabama and Southern Tennessee, and I was just didn't know how he would receive it if I said, I'm done. So I pick up the phone, I call Dad, I said, Dad, I came forward this morning at church, I told the preacher, God called me to preach. And Dad said, okay, tell your mama. Handed Mom the phone. Mom, and I'm just a blur because it's like, well, what does that mean? Is he mad? Is he happy? What does that mean? I don't know. Mom's like, well, that's real good, son. I'm proud of you. You know, you'll be a great preacher. You'll do real well at that. And in a minute, gave Daddy the phone back, and I'm back on the phone with Daddy, and he says, son, I needed a minute to get my composure. He said, in 1976, you were born with an underdeveloped kidney. That kidney died inside of you, and it began to poison your system. I knew that had happened. I have a large scar on my side where they removed that kidney. He said, but back then, that was a very serious surgery, and we didn't know whether you would live or die. He says, as a matter of fact, that's why you don't have any siblings. He said, it shook me up so bad. He says, I could take you to the place on the third floor of Children's Hospital in Birmingham, Alabama. I could show you the place in the hallway where you were on the gurney, lying there asleep, being wheeled back for surgery. And he said, I was praying, Lord, don't take him. And he said, I've never heard it like I heard it that night. He said, but God spoke to me very clearly and said, he will not die, he will live, and he will be a preacher. He said, I've waited 19 years for this phone call. Now, you can only imagine the confirmation that that was for me. He wasn't disappointed. He wasn't ashamed. He expected it. I said, Dad, why? Dad, I wanted to be a professional bass fisherman. You bought me a boat. What was up with that? I wanted to go to the moon, and you sent me to space camp. And you've supported everything I wanted to do, and you never told me that story. He said, son, I just didn't want it to be about me. He said, this has to come from the Lord. He said, it can't come from me. It's got to come from God. And I've wanted to support you in everything you've ever done, but this is between you and him. The confidence that gave me, I could have charged hell with a water gun. I was ready. Now, folks, I literally could tell you stories all day like that. There's many, many more. When God revealed to me that Julie was to be my wife, my hardest year in ministry in 2012, time will not permit it. But you've got to know, we serve a living God who from time to time steps out of eternity into time, into your reality. Be ready for it. Be watching for it. Be engaged in the ministry. Be tending the sheep. What does that mean? That means go by this ministry fair and sign up for something. Get busy. Be tending the sheep. And as you do, you will from time to time see something that's familiar yet different. And you'll want to step aside and get a little closer to see what that's all about. And if you listen carefully, you'll hear God speak your name. Let's pray. With every head bowed and every eye closed, every Sunday we ask God to use what we're doing to speak to people. For some of you, this is a burning bush experience. God is calling you. God is drawing you. You just sense that he wants you to do something. Maybe you don't know exactly what it is just yet. That's okay. He wants you to know more than you do. And he speaks very eloquently, very clearly to his sheep. It'll come. Are you listening? Maybe today God is saying to you, I'm the God of your grandma. I'm the one she used to pray to. I'm the God of your mother. You've heard her call my name. And today I'm visiting you. Someone once said that the opportunity of a lifetime only exists in the lifetime of that opportunity. It's a window. And during that window, you either respond or it passes. But if God is speaking to you today, if he's calling you to salvation, you come. Give your life to Jesus Christ. You'll look back on life and regret a lot of things. You won't regret that. In just a moment, I'm going to say a short prayer. When I say amen, you be ready. As soon as I say amen, you take that first step and you come. Find one of our pastors and just say, I want to be saved. Maybe you're here and God's calling you to some form of service like he did me. If it's something God's telling you to do, you come and let that be known. You get ready. Has it seemed like to you every sermon has been speaking to you about that? If so, maybe it is. When I say amen, you come. Some of you today, you know that you know that you know God's calling you to be a part of this family of faith. As soon as I say amen, you come and tell one of these pastors, I'm ready to join the church. Maybe as I pray, talk to God, but also talk to your family and see if they're ready. And if they're ready, you come. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you, O Lord, that you speak to your sheep and they hear your voice. And that, Lord, you haven't just set us out here to sail on the open seas without a rudder. But you've come down to captain our ship. God, it doesn't mean it'll always be smooth sailing, but Lord, you'll get us to the safe harbor. Until then, Lord, open our spiritual ears so that we can hear. Open our eyes that we may see. And use these people in a way that we can only dream. Speak now. We, your sheep, are listening. In Jesus' name we pray. Here it is. Amen. Let's stand. You come if God's calling.